It's highly recommended, especially for those of you who are in the ICMC, but also for everyone else. So it starts at 5, and they told me it's not going to be here.
Downstairs.
Okay. So, any of you is going to go? Yes. Okay, so we will finish at quarter to 5, like I said, and then you'll have time to rest for the okay, I checked your quizzes, they are in the drawer, in front of the secretary room. I want to make two things clear, because there are so many people living in Amsterdam, right? One is regarding the leakage comment. So I asked what would be the total current in case of if we are measuring the current at the resting potential. And I think maybe all of you answered 0. That is true. But then I asked what would happen if we will hyperpolarize the membrane, what would happen to the direction of the current, and I think the answers were half positive and negative, so I want to make this one clear. So if I'm looking at the leakage current, I can look at it like any other current. This is the total conductance of all the leakage channels. This is the driving force. So the membrane potential minus, and here I won't put the equilibrium potential because this is a combination of a lot of ions, but this will really be Vm according to GHK equation. Okay, so if according to GHK equation this is something like minus 70, so I would expect that if I'm measuring the membrane potential exactly at minus 70, then the leakage current will be 0. This is what you answered correctly. But now what will happen if I would apply some hyperpolarization? So let's say now this is minus 90 millivolts. Okay? So if I'm doing some hyperpolarization, this will be negative. Okay? Conductance is always positive. This is always. So, with hyperpolarization, I would expect that the leakage current should be negative. Okay? So, this is something that I guess wasn't clear to all of you. Another point is what are the contribution of the sodium-potassium ATPR to the resting potential? And again, some of you answered it right, but a lot of people didn't know the answer. So I want to emphasize what is going on. Essentially, what is happening is that this pump creates concentration gradient, right? This pump is free. Sodium ions out and two potassium ions in. And by that it's doing two things. One thing is that it creates a concentration gradient. So we will have more sodium over here and more potassium over here as compared to the other compartment. Now this concentration gradient in turn they create passive current. Right? Because of the concentration gradient, sodium we want to go into the cell and potassium will have a passive current out of the cell. These passive currents are actually what create the potassium. potential difference. It was most obvious in the case of clear cells when we saw that the pump creates concentration difference for potassium, and then we saw that this concentration gradient creates a flow of potassium out of the cell, and this flow creates a potential. Okay? But it's the same principle also if we are looking at both ions. Okay? So we create concentration gradients, then they will be passive currents, of course, and then the passive current will create potential difference. It's true that you can also look at it in another way if you are looking now at this fine situation. So you can say, okay, there are passive currents and the pump directly compensate for this current. If I'm looking now after this whole process occurs and I'm looking at the final situation, I will say the pump really balances the passive current. But this is really the logic of the event. There is concentration gradient, there are passive currents which create potential
difference.
Okay?
Can you explain why
the
passive currents create potential?
Again, it's easier to explain it in the case of glial cells. Let's say this is the membrane and this is the in and out, and for glial cells we only have channels for potassium. Okay? So we will have more. Due to the pump, you will have more potassium over here than over here. Okay? Potassium, let's say we start with zero potential. Potassium will flow out of the cell. Okay? And then, therefore, I will have a slight excess of positive charges over here as compared to here.
And it will flow out because of the pump? Or?
Because of the concentration difference. And then this process will stop when this potential will equal the equilibrium potential for potassium. So it will stop if they will create something like minus 85 millivolts, something like that. And then I will have flowing over here due to potential difference and flowing over here due to concentration. Okay, in this case, the passive current balances itself, so the pump can stop. Of course, it doesn't stop because there are a lot of processes in the cell which can degrade its gradient, except what we are discussing. Okay, in the neuron, it doesn't balance itself because no ion reaches its exact equilibrium potential. Because there are several ions which influence the resting potential, it won't stop exactly at the equilibrium potential of any ion separately. But still this principle holds. Okay? So still there will be concentration gradients for sodium and potassium. Sodium will flow in, will apply some depolarization, potassium will flow out, will apply some hyperpolarization. Okay? So both of them will create some potential difference, and it will come together into the resting potential according to GHK equation. Not it won't be exactly the equilibrium potential of one ion because there are several ions. So this is an important point. And of course the other contribution of the pump is the electrogenic contribution. And this is the fact that this pump three positive ions out and only two positive ions in. And this is causing some extra negative millivolts that are coming into the resting potential. So this is the answer I expected. There were a lot of answers which were very, very similar, but I felt that it's not entirely clear. Yes. Potential difference, and just this will occur, potential difference, I mean the voltage across the membrane. So this is something like, if this is most of the potential difference is due to this ago. This is, let's say, about minus 70 millivolts. And this can account for some extra minus 3 or minus 4 millivolts. So this will be something like this. And overall, you will have resting potential of minus 73. Okay, so if you have more questions regarding this point, I'll come to you in this way. So now let's carry on the action potential. So we just discussed the voltage-gated ion channels themselves. So the voltage-gated channels for sodium and for potassium, which are on the basis of the action potential process. So we said basically that we have three main types of voltage-dependent channels in neurons. There are a lot more, but three main types. The potassium channels, the calcium channels, which we didn't discuss yet, and the sodium channels. So we mainly discussed until now the potassium and the sodium channels over here. And we just saw the biological or molecular structure. So let's say this is one domain is the potassium channel, and we see here six alpha helices in this domain. We said that the fourth one is the voltage sensor of the channel, and the fifth with the sixth, along with some loop, P loop between them, this is the selectivity feature of the channel. So we see here that to create a whole potassium channel, we need this domain, which is one domain, and we need four of them. This is one, two, three, and the fourth one is coming out of the box, so we cannot see it. And we see here these P loops at the middle, they are creating the selectivity filter, and in field we see the fourth alpha helix, which is seen over here. This is really the voltage sensor. So what we said is that during evolution there was some process of duplication of this protein. And for the calcium channel, we don't need four separate proteins because there is one big protein which contains this domain four times. And so this is the calcium channel, but essentially it looks very, very similar to the potassium channel. And from the calcium channel, there was additional steps, and the sodium channel was created. The sodium channel developed somewhat at the time of the development of the nervous system. So it was specialized for the nervous system. But they are very, very similar. We said that it's enough to change two amino acids to make a channel from to deliver sodium instead of calcium. So regarding the voltage sensor, we said that we have this pink alpha helixes, which are alpha helix number 4, so we have 4 of them. And they are really, they contain amino acids which are positively charged. This is lysine and arginine. And really, when we are at rest, these positively charged amino acids are drawn by these negative charges in the interior side of the membrane. So they are lying within the membrane. But now, when there will be some depolarization, they will be repelled from these positive charges, and they will go outward. This going outward of these helixes, it will create some conformational change in the protein, and then it will open the pore in order for the channel to be able to deliver the ion. So it's not that they are themselves the gate, but they allow some conformational change which allow the opening of the gate, of the activation. So we see it's somewhat similar to the model of Hodgkin and Huxley, even though we have there were experimenting with, they showed that it's enough that three of them will move in certain channels and or four for potassium channels. So there has to be some other than two also with the molecular level. Then discuss the inactivation gate for sodium, and we said that there were some experiments in the 70s in which Armstrong inserted this enzyme, Pronaz, and Pronaz was inserted into the axon, into the squid axon, and this selectively destroyed the inactivation gate. So we see the experiment without the Pronaz, so we see the typical behavior of the current for sodium, so it rises and then okay. But here it's with the Pronaz, so we see the rise of the current, but then the current just persists. So it's very similar to what we see in potassium when we don't have any inactivation. The current just persists as long as the command potential would stay as it is. So that's all down from two things. One is that the activation and inactivation in the sodium channels are separable processes, because you can destroy one and not destroy the other. And the other is that it's probably in the interior side of the channel, because it perfuses Pronaz into the interior side of the axon. So Armstrong proposed a model which was called the Bollen-Chain model. It was found to be true, but not in the sodium channel that we discussed. It was found to be true in another type of voltage activated channel, which we didn't talk about yet, the channel for potassium type A. And the model he proposed is that there is a ball and a chain. So the chain is some sequence of amino acids. And here we have some globular sequence of amino acids. They are tied to the structure of the channel. And let's say that this ball is positively charged. And if we have some depolarization, this ball is coming inside the channel and just blocks the pore of the channel. So again, this model is true for one type of inactivation, but not for the type of channel we are discussing. In the sodium channel, here are the four domains that we discussed. And we have some loop between the third and the fourth domain, which is really the inactivation loop. So we have some amino acids in this loop, and this was, the structure of this loop was illustrated. So they called it the IFM motif, it's called over the name of the amino acid within this loop. And really, if you, for example, you put antibodies inside the axon specifically for this loop, you destroy the inactivation. So if you just hold the the inactivation loop. If you just hold it by antibodies, the inactivation cannot occur. Another experiment was, for example, to apply depolarization to create the inactivation, and then you are trying to insert the antibodies, and you see that in this case, the antibodies cannot tie to the loop, because in this case the loop is within the pore. So we see that this loop is specifically in charge of the inactivation, and that in case of inactivation, it's found within the pore of the channel, not outside. So we can see it over here, this is this loop, and this is in case of inactivation, the loop is inserted into the channel itself. This can maybe help us understand why the inactivation gate has a long time constant. For the activation gate, it's just charges which are moving over here. And for the inactivation, perhaps the time that it takes to the inactivation loop here, or to the ball and chain over here, to find its way into the core of the channel, maybe it takes it a longer time, therefore have a longer time constant for inactivation. gating current. So we see that during activation, this S4, the fourth helix, they are going out. And this causes some current, which people are able to measure. So they just measure the current, which is not due to the flowing of iron through the channel, but just through, due to the moving of charges within the proton itself. So it causes some very small current out, which people are able to measure. So what they did some voltage clamp experiments in which they applied the polarization, and they measured this gating current. So the gating current is really parallel, we can say, to the opening of the activation gate. So if we see gating current out, we know that the activation gate was open. So if I'm doing a very short experiment, let's say I started from something like this, which is short enough not to allow the inactivation to occur. Then I will see gating current out at the beginning, the activation gate is open. And at the end I will see gating current in. So this is the deactivation. So the activation gate got closed. This is if I'm doing the experiment so short that the inactivation cannot occur. So it's not in the time constant, it's not during the time of the time constant for inactivation. Now, if I will do a longer experiment, I will see the gating current out, I will see the activation gate open. But the current in is not occurring right at the end of the voltage step, but it delays. Okay, so there is some delay between the end of the voltage step and the deactivation. So what they concluded from this experiment that there is some connection between the activation and the inactivation. Because if there is no inactivation, the activation gate can just be open and then closed. If there is time, if there is enough time for inactivation, then we cannot really close the activation gate as long as the inactivation gate is also closed. So maybe we'll see in this picture that will be clearer. Let's say that this is the activation gate. So it can be open and closed. But once it got open and the inactivation gate got closed, the activation gate cannot come back. Okay, so when the inactivation gate is closed, the activation gate must be open. And after I will remove the depolarization, the inactivation gate will open and only then I will be able to close also the activation gate.
But what does it say to us when both of them?
So the channel will be closed either at this configuration when the inactivation gate is closed or at this configuration when the activation gate is closed. It's just a
what
nice fact.
Does it explain something on the graph there?
So you can see in this situation we have a very short depolarization. So what is happening is just that the activation gate gets open and then closed. If I'm doing a longer depolarization, what will happen is that the activation gate will get open, like here, and then the inactivation will occur.
It will stay high or different, more time,
yeah,
until it will get back. More time until the positive will go.
Exactly, we will have to have more time after the depolarization, so the inactivation gate will be able to move out, and then the activation gate get closed. Okay, so it's just some conformation of the channel which couples the activation gate and the inactivation gate. Yes?
Sorry, but I didn't understand. What is the gating?
When?
What?
What is the gating? It's the current which is actually created by the moving of the charges in the channel itself, in the fourth helix.
Yes, exactly.
Yes, so there. It's apparent that people are able to measure it. And just conception of voltage-dependent potassium channel was known, I think, 15 years ago, but for sodium it was only very recently mapped. Didn't bring the picture, but you can now see the whole three-dimensional lecture. And this is really the area of the selectivity filter, so this will be the area which will choose the ions that the channel conducts. And you can see that it's made up of these three loops that we saw, and the frequency alpha helices of each domain. And basically, we have some amino acids as before, over here, which contain negatively charged oxygen atoms. Glutamic acid, this is the type of amino acid which is found over here. And they are really containing negatively charged carboxylic groups, so negatively charged oxygen atoms. And they are there to really, this is the first step, so this is just the outer flow of the channel. And this is just serving to. So it serves to repel the anions, to repel negatively charged ions, and to draw or to attract positively charged ions. But this is not specific for sodium, it can also attract calcium, for example. But more internally, in the core of the channel itself, we have a more restricted region. You see, this is a small region, 0.3 to 0.5 nanometer. So a very strict region, which can only allow the transfer of sodium. So if you remember, we had the sodium in the solution, and it was stabilized by water molecules. And now this very, very small area over here is allowing the sodium to pass only with one water molecule. Okay, so it stabilizes this structure. And it won't stabilize the structure of potassium. Okay, so it will stabilize only this kind of structure, so only sodium can go through this channel and complete the by the way, I think it's Van der Waals connection. Now we're going to think about it. Okay, here you see just the three-dimensional structure for potassium, so you see the four domains over here. You can see that people here we see potassium voltage dependent potassium channel. This is from bacteria, it's not from neurons, but they are very similar. So we see here two of the domains, and we see here just the selectivity filter for potassium. It's also made out of negatively charged oxygen ions, but in different configurations. And we can see possible places that people are able to map and to say where the potassium ions are really bound, or where the stabilization of potassium ions is done. So in this case, they found four sites in which potassium is able to bound to the channel, but it doesn't have to bound to all four of them at once. It can be the alternative place, but these are the places which people are able to bound. So from this kind of structure, if you know the three-dimensional structure of a protein, you are able to do some numerical simulation. I want to show you over here. This is called molecular dynamics. So molecular dynamics is a field in which people can simulate some environment, some chemical environment. So for example, in this case, they are simulating the environment of the voltage-dependent potassium channel. So if we know the three-dimensional structure, we will put in the simulation channel, we'll put the membrane, we'll put the water, and we will put some potassium ions near the channel. And then people are just doing numerical simulation based happen if we start from this situation, what will happen to the molecules. Then they are able to calculate some parameters, let's say the free energy, velocity, or any other thing that interests you to them. You cannot do it for a very long simulation because you accumulate errors as you go. But if you are interested in a very specific step, so you are able to do the simulation and to see what is happening. So in this article over here, they did the molecular dynamics and they tried to understand how come ions are going so quickly through the potassium channel. So why the speed of flow through the channel is so fast. So they chose some states with some ions, and for each state they really measured the free energy. So what we see over here are maps of free energy for different states of ions within the channel. So if we are at blue, we see this is a low free energy, and if we see red, this is high free energy. And we see here what is most important. We have here two alternative states of how ions are going through the potassium channel. So let's go through this group. We see here three ions within the potassium channel, and then another third ion is going into the pore and really repels the other ions, which are expelled there at the outer side of the channel. And in this group, we see it, the same beginning and the same end, but here the ions themselves within the channel are going up before the third ion is going in. So to sum up the difference between these two rules, let's say in both of them we have two potassium ions which are in the channel. And let's say one is over here. In the first situation, this ion is going over here, repels this ion, and then this ion is expelled. In this situation, they are going out, and then we have place for this ion. And we see that this route in which the next ion repels the other, it has a lower free energy than this route, in which first the ions are going out and then another ion is going in. So what they actually concluded is that it should be that this route will be the correct one. So we have some interaction between the next ion, which is really pushing the ions which are within the channel, so it's pushing them out. So this is one interaction, and the other interaction are the bonds between the channel and the ions themselves. So this stabilizes the ion, but this one repels the ion and pushes them out. And this is really also to show the same thing. They really show that if ions are stuck within the channel and we have another ion out but it's not repelling them, we'll have some we have some hold of the free energy. So we have some drop in the free energy, so the ions won't be able to go out of the channel. But if we have other ions that will repel the ions within the channel, this will disappear, and we can have just a drop in the free energy, so the ions can just go out of the channel. So here we have some barrier of free energy, which we can cross. But if we have more ions which will repel the ions within the channel, this barrier will just disappear and the ions will just be able to go out. So they said, yes.
How much are the simulations are be reliable or something to be reliable.
To some extent, if it's to a very, very short period of time, so it's considered to be reliable to some extent. Of course, you would want to somehow check it experimentally. This would be the best thing to do. But if it's a very respected field of like we said, the basic mechanism for resting potential is due to the channel we discussed. We discussed the voltage-dependent sodium and potassium channels. They are the most important ones. But in neurons, we will find a lot of other types of channels. Each neuron contains very different types of ion channels. They can be in the dendrites, they can be in the axon, they can be different in different branches of the axon. And each one of them will influence how the neuron expresses the action potential, what is the shape of the action potential, how fast it propagates, and so on. So a lot of the properties of the action potential will be influenced by the specific channels and the distribution of these channels in the neuron. So it's possible that we have an axon which in this branch will have some channels, once it starts, it propagates the same energy to the end of the axon. But now we know that if there are other channels over here in the way, we can actually change the shape of the action potential. And we see later why it will actually influence what the next one will get.
Isn't it learning
is more at the area of the synapse itself. You are right that it can be a part of learning. Usually people talk about learning when they talk about connection between two cells. But learning is indeed also what is happening to the same cell. So what this is different computation of the same cell. People are actually not referring to it as learning, but it's probably part of it. So I want just to introduce a few types of channels which are very common in different neurons. So we have the edge type channels. They are open in single polarization, and they are non-specific cation channels. So they conduct positive ions, but it's not specific to one type of ion. Usually they cause depolarization. We also have calcium channels, calcium voltage-dependent channels. We talk a lot about them. They are very important in neurons. So these are usually opened by depolarization. And they cause depolarization. We also have the chloride voltage dependent channels. We have A type potassium channel. So these are voltage dependent channels which actually open depolarization. But they also have inactivation. So if you remember what I showed you, the ball and stick, the ball and chain. So the the volume change was actually the inactivation gate for DIN channel. So they offer depolarization, but they can also go through inactivation, like we learned about the regular sodium channel. And we also have a lot of different channels. I'm just introducing the main family. Each one of these are families of channels, but we have a lot of more channels. Some of them are dependent in voltage, some of them are dependent in chemical molecules, some of them depend on other factors like food on supply, pressure, and so on. Each one of them will be responsible for the specific traits of the neuron, how it responds to stimuli, how it propagates the action potential, and it's called really the computation that the neuron is able to do. So I don't know if we'll reach this part of the lecture, but you can actually take a model of a specific channel within a neuron and see what is the kind of computation that the single neuron is able to do. So for now, I just want to introduce several examples regarding what can happen due to different types of channels. So each one of these examples is an example of the influence of a type of specific channels which are found in the neuron.
You didn't mention the sodium channels, right?
The sodium channels which you already learned about?
You didn't mention now any sodium channels. When?
Yes, I didn't. But the egg type also conducts sodium, really. But no, you have also different types of sodium channels. Okay, so
but they are not that significant in that.
I just want to say something that I'm not entirely sure about. But there are really enormous amount of types of channels. The most important one in sodium is the one we discussed.
Of the.
Okay, so here we are doing some experiments. Let's look at A. And let's say we are applying some depolarization. And then, let's see the behavior over here. What is happening is just a train of action potentials. So we get action potentials one after the other. And this is expected by Oshkin-Lasky model. So if we will just put the channels we already know over here, this is what we will get due to continuous depolarization. We will get range of action potential. But now, this neuron also has a different type of channel. And what will happen if we will apply some hyperpolarization and only then the depolarization? So we hyperpolarization and only then depolarization. And what we'll see that when we will apply the depolarization itself, we will have some delay. So the train of action potential will not start at once, like in this case, but we will have some delay and only then this train will start. This kind of behavior is due to another channel which is found in this neuron, and this is really the A-type potassium channel, which we just discussed. This channel opens at depolarization. It causes hyperpolarization because potassium is leaving the cell. And at the resting potential, it has this property that we said it has the inactivation. So let's try to explain these two behaviors according to the property of this channel. So in the first case, we were at the resting potential, and then we applied some depolarization, and we saw the usual train of action potential. This is because the channel of potassium was at inactivation. that we did depolarization because it was inactivated to begin with. Now, if we are doing this experiment, first we are applying some hyperpolarization and only then depolarization. We will remove the inactivation first. We did hyperpolarization, so we removed the inactivation. And only then we apply depolarization, so we open the channel. And the channel itself causes some hyperpolarization. So potassium flew out of the cell, and therefore the action potential wasn't able to happen. But we have some hyperpolarization due to this A-type potassium channel. And therefore we had here some delay until the channel was inactivated as usual, and then just the normal drain of action potential was
on the first part, you said that it was inactivated from the first place.
I will try to repeat it and then I hope it will be clearer. Okay. We have, this is the same neuron here and here, but two different experiments. One in which I just apply normal depolarization, and the other is when I'm applying hyperpolarization and only then I'm crossing the threshold. This is over here. And we have this channel, the A-type potassium channel. We also have the normal channels of potassium and sodium which we discussed, which create the action potential. But we also have some additional type of channel, and this is the A-type potassium channel. This channel, if I'm at the resting potential, it in a state of inactivation. It cannot operate. If I'm doing some depolarization, it will be activated, it's open, and what it's doing is causing hyperpolarization because potassium will flow out of the cell. So let's say, if I'm in this case, here I'm at resting potential, so here the channel will be inactivated. Then I applied depolarization. The channel is activated, so the activation gate is open, but it's still also inactivated because I didn't open the inactivation gate. So essentially it's closed and it doesn't have any input. So I just have the usual drain of action potential.
Which is due to what?
Due to the normal voltage-dependent sodium and potassium channel. So
no,
we learned
about,
not this one. Okay? Now, I will do another type of experiment. Here I was at the resting potential. So I was at the state of inactivated channel. But then, I did hyperpolarization first. So I removed the inactivation. And only then I apply the depolarization, so here I have an activated channel which doesn't have any inactivation. And so in this case, the channel is starting to operate over here. Potassium is leaving the cell. I have some hyperpolarization which is actually delaying the start of action potential. Essentially, this hyperpolarization could have come from inhibitory input. So maybe it came from another neuron. And in this case, it would be interesting. Because we would say, okay, inhibitory input is able to delay the action potential. And we will see that the temporal sequence or the temporal profile of the action potential is important. So if we have some delay, this can signal something else in the output of the neuron. Yes.
But how do you know that the delay is because of this channel and not just because we hyperpolarize the cell and then we need to depolarize more before we get the action potential?
Okay, so you would have to make a control experiment to, for example, specifically block this channel and do the same experiment with and without this blocking.
But basically what I'm trying to say is that if I just do hyperpolarization and there's no
completed. I don't think it should be delayed. But you know what, we can try to the simulation and see if there is any this time difference. It won't be a question, but but it's just interesting to see. I must say that in the articles I read, people are doing a very controlled experiment, usually not with, usually they will applaud experimentally hyperpolarization, or they don't apply the hyperpolarization, and they will see that the currents are due to this channel, they check it, and then they will say, okay, it can also happen due to some inhibitory input, so this channel has some role. Another thing people are doing, and it's working pretty good, is to just build a very detailed simulation of the neuron with all the channels, and each channel has its own time constant and its own conductance and so on, and they are trying to reproduce this behavior, and this is another support. Okay, here we have similar but maybe reverse case. Here we have a calcium channel, also open at depolarization, coded depolarization, since calcium will go into the cell, and also have inactivation at rest. So here what they did is very similar experiment. They also applied in one case only depolarization, and in the other case hyperpolarization and then depolarization. But this time the depolarization didn't cross the threshold. Okay? So we had in both cases depolarization which didn't cross the threshold of the neuron. And we see that if we only did depolarization, which didn't cross the threshold, then we only get some electrotonic response, we won't get any action potential. But in this case, if we did first hyperpolarization and only then some minor depolarization, all of a sudden we get some bursts of action potential. This is mainly due to the same reason. Here, what we got is due to the hyperpolarization, the inactivated, we remove the inactivation. So now the calcium channel was ready to open. Then we did some depolarization, so we activated the calcium channel. And this calcium channel added some extra depolarization. So this is just the reverse of what happened here. Here the potassium channel applied more hyperpolarization, so we found some delay, or it caused some delay. Here the calcium channel, when it's open, it's giving us more depolarization, and therefore we are able to reach the threshold, and we have a train of action potential.
The hyperpolarization gave us, it shut the inactivation of?
Yeah, it removed the inactivation.
Of the calcium.
The calcium channel now, and therefore it was activated when we applied some depolarization. Okay, the last case I want to introduce, this is not so interesting, so just let's introduce this neuron. We have some neurons which are oscillatory neurons, which are able to, without any input, they are able to fire on their own at some reaches. Okay, so they are able to just fire at a certain frequency without any input. And the question is, how this is happening, how this behavior of firing, rhythmic firing is occurring. So in this case, this is a combination of H-type channel and voltage-dependent calcium channel. depolarization is enough to open the calcium channel. So the third thing that is happening is that this forces the current calcium channel open. And then this channel adds some more depolarization. So we have more depolarization, enough to reach to the threshold of action potential. And then we have the firing. Okay? So we have the firing over here. Then after a while we have inactivation of this, inactivation of calcium channel. And this channel we just get closed because it's open only at hyperpolarization, so deactivation of H-type channel. And then we just go back to normal. And this process is just will repeat itself in cycles. So by the time constant of these channels, by the interactions between these channels, we just create this rhythm which is repeating itself over and over again. Of course, the action potentials themselves will occur due to the sodium and potassium channels which you already know. Okay. So these are a lot of words about some cases which involve the most abundant or the most common channels. Question?
These were like explanations of the phenomenon. Now we talk about the delay, like we have not delays, but decreasing the threshold level.
If
I'm doing like hyperpolarization, I'm getting the threshold down.
Yeah, so this is due to the inactivation of the sodium channels we discussed. These are slightly different cases in which we have additional behaviors due to other channels. So we already saw the behaviors due to the sodium and potassium for the preparing channel. But here we see some more complicated behaviors because we have some other channels.
Can you explain how the adaptation is happening? The accommodation?
Are you talking about this one?
Yeah, the patient.
Okay, we'll say it, but there are different mechanisms of adaptation at the level of the single neuron. It can happen also due to very different mechanisms. Here is just a case in which you have the normal channel, but you also have a channel for potassium, which can actually, it's open very slowly. So here you apply depolarization, there was one action potential, but then the channel opens and there is no more action potential since it's causing hyperpolarization. So the channel just has a very slow kinetic and it allows for one spike, but then it's causing hyperpolarization. Here you can apply a neurotransmitter which is actually able to block this channel. And therefore you are allowing all the action potentials to be associated, as long as this neurotransmitter is available. We'll talk about other mechanisms also for the patient. Okay. Just a word about calcium channels. We'll talk about them a lot when we talk about the synapse, because they are very important in the area of the synapse itself. And we see that the membrane of nerve and muscle fibers contain a variety of voltage-dependent calcium channels. They are also very important in muscle contraction. In some neurons, we see that the calcium currents are actually important to the driving phase of action potential. So if we are talking about... Here we discuss some behaviors which are not related specifically to the action potential. maybe also influenced in some neurons, not only by sodium, like we know, but also by voltage-dependent calcium channels. Calcium has two positive charges. So calcium, really the equilibrium potential for calcium is 120 millivolts. Because it's almost absent within the cell, we don't have a lot, we have a very large potential concentration difference across the membrane for calcium. So you see, like we learned about sodium, which has something like 55 millivolts, we have some positive feedback, and we are able to create a positive feedback because potassium will go into the cell, then we have more depolarization, more voltage-dependent calcium, instead potassium and calcium, so more voltage-dependent calcium channel will get open, and then we have more depolarization. This is exactly the same thing that we discussed with sodium, can also potentially happen with potassium and contribute to this rising state of action. It's not happening in all the neurons. Okay? The usual mechanism is with sodium and potassium, but we have some neurons which also have some contribution of calcium. So one of these neurons is found in the cerebellum. This is found over here. And this is a brain area which actually is important for sensory integration, for coordination, for motor aspects, for timing, a lot of things in this area. And so let's go into this area. This is the cerebellum. We are going into a slice of it. And I want just to take you to this cell, which has some action potentials which are occurring due to sodium, and some action potentials which are occurring due to calcium. So if we will look at this cerebellum, we see this kind of cell in black over here, and this cell is called Purkinje cell. Okay. And this cell, it has a very unique shape. It has a very, very elaborated dendritic tree, very, very complex dendritic tree. But it's flat, it's found over here, it's not like something like this, it's just found like this on one dimension. Over here, and you have a lot of Purkinje cells at the cortex of the cerebellum, the outer layer of the cerebellum. And it's innervated by two types of cells. So let's see the innervation of the Purkinje cell. You will see also in black the Purkinje cell. And we have two types of cells which really innervate it. One is the climbing fiber. Okay. So we have the climbing fiber. The climbing fiber really wraps itself around the cell body and the dendritic tree of the Purkinje cell, and it has a very, very strong synapse with this cell. So this is one type of connection. The other connection is coming from other type of cells. This is granule cells. And these type of cells, they also have some unique configuration. They send their axons in parallel, like this. So the axons are called parallel fibers. So the innervation is due to the climbing fibers, and due to the granule cells, and the granule cells themselves, they project their axons in this parallel manner to a lot of Purkinje cells. This connection is very specific. So one climbing fiber can innervate maybe between 1 to 10 Purkinje cells, but one Purkinje cell will get input only from one climbing fiber. So if you are talking about the Purkinje cell, it gets input only from one climbing fiber. This connection, we have a lot of them. We have hundreds of parallel fibers, or thousands of parallel fibers, which are going through the dendritic tree. and each of them is creating a synapse with the computer set, but these are very, very weak synapses. Now, what is happening at the level of output of the computer set? So we have, like we have two types of input, each one of them is causing a different type of output. So the parallel fibers are really, we need a lot of them to activate the computer set. We need a lot of synapses to operate at once to get the computer set to work. And it creates what is called a simple spike. Just a spike or an action potential, which is the normal action potential we learn about. This is the action potential due to sodium at the rising phase of the action potential. If a climbing fiber will operate, it's enough that this one climbing fiber will operate. We don't need integration of a lot of inputs like here. It's enough that one of them will operate. And what we'll have is what is called complex spike. So this is a longer spike with a larger amplitude and a larger duration, which is actually causes, which is actually created if the climbing fiber is operating, and then the computer cell will fire a complex spike. And this complex spike is due to calcium. So it's not in the regular mechanism of sodium. It's created, or the rising phase of this spike is created by calcium. Each one of these sources, the climbing fiber or the granule cell, the parallel fiber, they're bringing inputs from a lot of sources, motor sources, sensory sources, and so on. The parallel fibers are operating all the time in response to a lot of changes in the sensory or the motor environment, and we have them firing all the time, hundreds of times per second. And the Purkinje cells will have, the climbing fiber will operate in a very low frequency, let's say 1 to 3 spikes per second, and they can signal, for example, the beginning of some event, the beginning of some sensory event, the beginning of some motor event, and also other stuff. We don't know if we want to get into it now, but we see different sources of input. Each one of them will create another output in different mechanisms. One mechanism is action potential based on sodium, and the other one is action potential which is based on calcium. Okay. Now, one of the more interesting things that we can do is to see the train of action potentials of a neuron, to see the temporal sequence, the temporal profile of action potential, and try to understand what the neuron is encoding, what is actually the representation of this train of action potential. And this is special for neurons, because if we will see, for example, the activity of a liver cell, we won't think that this activity represents something else. It's just the activity of the liver cell. It does something supposed to do. But with neurons, the activity is supposed to represent something. So the activity may represent what I'm just looking at, or to represent what I'm hearing, or what I'm thinking about, and so on. So we have some additional aspects of the activity, of the physiological activity, not just the physiological activity per se. So essentially, this is a lot of the research that is done in brain science. We will see the activity of neurons, and we will try to elucidate what they are representing. What are the parameters in the environment, or in the thoughts, or in the actions that are actually represented. So in some cases, it is more easy to know this. In some cases, it's not so easy. But essentially, I don't know, there are some projects today, like the connectomes, if you know, to see what are the whole connections that we have in our brain. And if we know all the connections and we know each spike, what does it say, so essentially we can know what, we can look at the activity of the brain and know what the what people are looking at, what they are thinking, and so on. So this is just like the middle goal of brain research. So let's look at two neurons in the periphery, not in the brain, and here we can fairly say what these spikes are representing. So this is, for example, an axon of a neuron, which is found at the periphery, and this neuron is in charge on signaling pressure, mechanical pressure. So if I'm pressuring my hand, I want to know that there was some pressure, and this neuron should respond to it. So this is the end of the neuron, and it's found in the skin and in the joint of the delta. And it's trapped with some capsule, which is called the Cuccinian capsule, or Rufus Cuccini in Greek. And it should deliver mechanical pressure. Now, if we will apply a pressure, the first thing that will happen is that this capsule will get squashed, and then some mechanical dependent channels within the neuron will get open, and then we have an action potential. Okay, so here we are talking about mechanical dependent channels. So this is what will happen if I will apply the stimulus of pressure which is on. After the first action potential, what is happening is some change in the capsule, and the capsule itself absorbs all the pressure, and it won't deliver it back to the neuron. So if I'm talking about one long pressure, I will see an action potential at the beginning and at the end. In the middle, I won't have any influence because the capsule itself absorbs all the pressure. If I will have a different type of pressure, which is vibration, like this, something like this, then the capsule won't absorb the pressure, because each time it's like a new mechanical pressure. And then we will see an action potential per each vibration, per each pressure on the skin. And in this case, you might say, okay, the action potential is actually representing the frequency of the mechanical pressure on the skin. So it's very straightforward. You see the same infection potentials, you know what was the stimulus on the skin. Of course, there will be other neurons which will respond to this kind of stimulus and not so well to this kind of stimulus, so you want to know, to be able to tell what the stimulus. So this is one example of how we know from the action potentials, how we know what is happening in the surroundings. Here we have another example, and this is some thermal receptor or a neuron which is able to encode the temperature in the skin. So the temperature of the skin is something like 34 Celsius degrees, a little lower than the temperature in the body. And we can apply some cooling in certain amounts of degrees, and to see what's happening to the firing of this neuron. So if we cool the temperature by 10 degrees, we will see a high frequency firing. If we cool it by only, let's say, 2 degrees, we'll have some increase in the firing, but not so much, or not in the high frequency that we found over here. So the frequency in this case will actually symbolize the temperature in the skin. This neuron, I see, it seems that there is some adaptation over here.
No, because after the cooling, there was no potential.
No, this is the... after the cooling, I don't know if it's just an example or with the data. It's possible that there is some after effect, after the cooling. Okay, so sometimes we are able to do the same thing with neurons in our brain. So sometimes we are able to record the activity of neurons within the brain and to know what they actually represent. So for example, I don't know if we didn't emphasize this much. But let's say that getting the information from all our body in the sense of information, for touch, for pressure, for proprioceptive information, all the sense of information which is from the body, not vision or auditory information, but from the body it's all coming into here. And this M1, this is the last place that sends motor commands to the body. So this place will send commands to the hand, to the leg, to the face, and so on. And we are able to take neurons from these two regions, also from other regions, because we will talk about this region, and to understand what is the meaning of action potentials in this region. So for example, over here, we see the activity of one neuron if we just place an object on the hand. So what this neuron actually is coding is the orientation of the object. So we see if I place it like this, in horizontal manner, it will fire aloft. If I will do something like this, or like this, it will fire left. Okay? So we see it will fire left in vertical position or in diagonal position. So this neuron is really responsible to representing the orientation of objects on our body. Another neuron over here is able to represent the direction of movement of an object on our body. So whether I'm going over here or over here or in any other direction. So we see here that this neuron, for example, will fire, if I'm going in this direction, it will fire more. Will fire less if I'm going in other direction, and the reverse direction it will fire very very small amount of action potential. So this will be the preferred direction of this neuron, and this is what is called the null direction. So these are very common terms. Is really the amount of firing versus the parameter. So in this case, the parameter is the direction of the object on our body. So it has one preferred direction in which it fires the most, and other direction it will fire less and less until the null direction in which it will almost not fire. And this kind of tuning curve is very, very common in different places in our brain. So in vision, for example, in the visual cortex, we will have also a tuning curve, but for example, the angle of a line, or the direction of a dot, which is run in front of our eye. In the auditory cortex, we also have this tuning curve for the frequency of sound, for example. So this is a very common way of organization. And of course, I will have one neuron in which this will be his tuning curve, but I will have other neuron in which it will have another tuning curve. So each neuron has its own preferred direction. So I may have a lot of neurons, each one of them with a slightly different tuning curve. So this is in the primary motor cortex, in which people also saw the same phenomenon. So when a monkey is moving a joystick, and it's moving in a certain direction, we have a lot of firing. But then, when it will move in other directions, the firing will drop, again, according to this constant shape of the tuning curve. Okay, so this is the encoding, okay? Just wrote them encoding. This is how the neuron is taking parameters from the outer surrounding. person just saw a bear, or maybe that he just thought about his grandmother, or he just moved his hand. I want to try to say something clever about this after thought. Any idea how I might feel its brain of person potential? How can I say something about what is
like the
Okay, you are right. So zero is the time of the experiment, and we see that the firing is before that. So we might attribute the role of planning to zero. So what I'm reading between the lines here is that we need to conduct a very careful experiment with certain parameters which can tell us something about this neuron. For example, now we have a lot of knowledge, so maybe if this is a something which has to do with movement, I will put my electrode in the motor cortex and I will try to see based on the experiment what is the role of this neuron. So for the timing, for example, the timing can give us a clue of what this neuron is actually representing. Actually, if I'm putting it in a very general perspective, I will try to see how can I explain the firing of the neuron based on the parameters of the experiment. And this can be, like you said, the timing. It can be what parameters am I changing at different tracks of the experiment and how the firing of the neuron is changing. And there are a lot of techniques to see if there is some connection between the profile of action potentials and the parameters of the experiment. If you are interested in something in the brain, you can start with different techniques. But there are a lot of ways, correlations, classifications, mutual information, then the variance, a lot of, I don't know if it tells you anything now, but a lot of ways in which we can associate the firing to the parameters of the experiment. But still, all of them is based on the same major theme. So we need to build an experiment. And essentially what we are doing by that is to dividing the world to only a set of options. So if I'm doing an experiment in which I'm changing the velocity and the amplitude of movement, then this is everything that I can find out. I can find out whether the firing is related to velocity of movement or to amplitude.
Same neuron will participate in many experiments, but each one has a special role firing for special cause.
Okay?
Each neuron will fire always for the same situation, the same way, or it can do different again.
No, this is another thing. We have some variation. So you would expect that if the neuron is let's say, like here for preparation, and these are different repetitions of the same experiment, you will get a similar trend. But it's not saying that you will get the exact same temporal profile. And people are starting to think about it, whether we should address the average, or whether we should know the exact time of each spike, and so on. Still, you are restricted to the parameters within the experiment. So maybe it seems very easy because you can do an experiment and you can, I don't know, I'm doing it in my PhD, so I'm doing an experiment and then I have some signals from the brain and I'm trying to predict what the person did. And wow, sometimes I'm very successful and it's very, very nice. But for example, if I'm talking about the motor cortex, this is supposed to be not so complicated rhythm because it just sends commands directly to the spinal cord or to the hand. But people are arguing for decades what the neurons in the motor cortex are actually representing. They're representing motor force, muscle force, angle of the joint, only the end of my hand, the velocity. People actually found that the firing of the neurons in the motor cortex are related to all these parameters. So it's very pressing, because if, for example, this is, let's say, a neuron which can call for green or for red, in both cases it fires two spikes, but in this case, this is the temporal profile, and in this case a slightly different temporal profile, which will signal different colors. But if the field I'm measuring, let's take the bin of time that I'm measuring is this bin, I won't be able to tell the difference. Okay? So if, like people are doing often, I will address the average firing rate and not the exact temporal profile, I won't be able to tell the difference. Or if my classification method is not that accurate, or it's accurate but it's not able to grasp a certain aspect of the firing, so maybe I will say that there is no connection when there will be a connection. Another thing is a mixture of parameters. I will finish this point and then we can let's go to the break.
Thank you.
בסופו של דבר מה שקורה פה זה ש... של מה שעובר בסופר. בזמן היא כמו ההתקדמות שאנחנו למדנו עליה בזמן, כאילו זה פשוט הזמן שייקח לה להגיע ל...
Thank you.